J.
Good morning.
Good morning,
and good morning to you at home, or on Zoom, or on Facebook, or later on YouTube. And do we have any visitors this morning? Okay, so welcome. I know you want to go under the, right, I'm sorry. For those of you who don't know me or at home, I'm Reverend Dr. Debra Hafner. My pronouns are she, her, and I am the interim minister here. So you all know it's Fire Drill Sunday. And did you remember to bring your coats in with you? If you didn't bring your coat in with you, I would suggest during candle lighting would be a good time to get it. At least it's not raining. And the fire drill will be after my closing words. Okay, so don't even think about it for this next period of time. You all know my closing words by now? May our real service begin. And when I say that, and you actually can start joining in with me on those if you'd like. Graham Otten, where are you, Graham? In the back. Our fire marshal is going to come forward and give you directions. The children are not with us today, nor are the teachers, which is why it looks a little empty. Because of this being a shortened service, Danielle wanted to make sure that she would have a full class today. After the fire drill, when we get the all clear, if you are a member, what are you going to do? You're going to come back because we have a really important meeting and we have a vote and we need a quorum for that vote. And the board needs to also share some news with you. Because of the fire drill and the important meeting, I've decided to cancel the newcomers coffee for today. So we will hold one for those of you who are new or new-ish on January 8th. And if for those of you who are visiting today, come back another week because today's going to be a little odd. The other thing that I want to do, Lee, where are you? In the back. Okay, Lee is going to pass out some clipboards. I hope you have seen on the flash that we are trying to organize a text messaging system so that if there's something we need to let you know quickly, We don't have to put an email together. If there's a protest, if church is canceled because of snow, those kind of things, I promise we won't text you more than 5 times a month and you can opt out. But if you have not signed up, we're passing around a clipboard. If you would just pass it up and down the rows and Lee will get them in the back at the end. This will be a really important way to stay in touch with you. Okay, those are the announcement part of mine. Jenna will have some more. This service is called the Interim Service Part 2. You may remember or not that Part 1 was on November 6th, where I talked about UUFH's history, the ambivalence about ministerial authority that is baked into your history, and the declining trends in membership and budget. So today I'm going to be sharing about other issues that I've been observing, a bit about governance, and I'm going to introduce you to the beginning of the search process, which is choosing a search committee. One of the 8 goals the board established for my time with you is to hold up a mirror to you so that as the congregation, you will decide who you can be and how you want to go forward. In that spirit, I have chosen words for the opening words that I'm guessing most of you will have heard before, but it's likely been a long time. These are from Unitarian Universalist minister, the Reverend Robert Fulham, and I don't know if you knew that he was a Unitarian Universalist minister. How many of you remember reading his little book, All I Really Need to Know? So from the opening. All I really need to know about how to live and what to do and how to be, I learned in kindergarten. Wisdom was not at the top of the graduate school mountain, but in the sand pile at my Sunday school. These are the things I learned. Share everything. Play fair. Don't hit people. Put things back where you found them. Clean up your own mess. Don't take things that aren't yours. Say you're sorry. Wash your hands before you eat. He didn't know about COVID, apparently. Now we would say, wash your hands all the time. Flush. Please. Warm cookies and milk are good for you. Live a balanced life. Learn some, think some, draw and paint and sing and dance and play and work every day. Take a nap every afternoon. When you go out into the world, watch for the traffic, hold hands and stick together. Be aware of wonder. Remember the little seed in the styrofoam cup? The roots go down, the plant goes up, and nobody really knows how or why it happens, but we're all like that. Goldfish and hamsters and white mice and even the little seed in the styrofoam cup, they all die. So do we. And then remember the Dick and Jane books. How many of you started on the Dick and Jane books, right? The first word you learned, the biggest word of all, look. Look. Everything you need to know is in here somewhere. The golden rule and love and basic sanitation. Ecology and politics and equality and sane living. Take any of those terms and extrapolate it into sophisticated adult terms and apply it to your family life or your work or our government or the world, and it still holds true. Think what a better world it would be if the whole world had cookies and milk at 3 o'clock every afternoon and then laid down on our blankies for a nap. Or if all governments had a policy to always put things back where they found them and to clean up their own mess. And it's still true, no matter how old you are, when you go out into the world, it is better to hold hands and stick together. And so in that spirit, please rise in body or in spirit and join us in the opening hymn, Gather the Spirit. The words will be on the screen.
Thank you. Good morning. I'm Jenna Kern-Rugiel, and my pronouns are she, her. And now I'll ask Amy Olander, who introduced me to the fellowship in 1996, to join me to light our chalice. The following reading, called Community Means Strength, is by Starhawk. We are all longing to go home to some place we have never been, a place half remembered and half envisioned, we can only catch glimpses of from time to time, community. Somewhere, there are people to whom we can speak with passion without having the words catch in our throats. Somewhere, a circle of hands will open to receive us, eyes will light up as we enter, voices will celebrate with us whenever we come into our own power. Community means strength that joins our strength to do the work that needs to be done, arms to hold us when we falter, a circle of healing, a circle of friends, someplace where we can be free. Have a few announcements today. As you all know, the holiday season has arrived, and it's a very special time here at the Fellowship. Here are some ways for you to get involved in our beloved community. It's your chance to be a star in a movie that will be specially made for our Christmas Eve service. Please email Sandra at office@uufh.org with pictures of your holiday celebrations, holiday card photos, or celebrations of December holidays from this year or last. Speaking of stars, there's just 1 week left to take part in our annual holiday toy drive called Star Child for the Family Service League's Project Toy. You can select a star, which is a toy or gift card suggestion, from the display in the social hall. Please bring all unwrapped toys and gifts to the bin in the social hall no later than December 11th. We also welcome cash donations, which we will use to purchase gift cards. For more information, contact Allison Barish. On Wednesday, December 14th, Lisa Burby will be hosting the annual ornament exchange at her Northport home. Please bring a wrapped ornament of no more than $20 in value and some treats. There are always lots of treats. Contact Lisa for more information. Also, all ages are invited to join our UUFH community caroling event on December 16th from 7 to 9 p.m. in the social hall. Bring holiday cookies and enjoy some hot chocolate as our talented UUFH musicians accompany us in singing holiday songs. And there are many more joyful holiday events at the Fellowship this month, so please look for the recent email dated December 2nd with the subject line Happy Holidays to learn more. And as Reverend Debra mentioned, please come back after the fire drill for the important vote. We'll see you after the service. And now, please join me in saying our mission statement, which is on the screen. In religious community, we nurture our individual spirits through caring for one another and helping to heal the world.
I was making a note for later in the service. Thank you, Jenna, and thank you for those words. We're going to watch a video now. It's kind of scary looking, huh? Most congregations share similar complexities and similar problems, whether they are Christian or Jewish or Unitarian Universalist, whether they are big or small. A synagogue in Ohio has created a set of funny videos about these complexities. A few weeks ago, on four different subjects, at four different meetings on one day, someone said the same thing to me in response to an idea I had put out there. I went out to my colleagues and said, "Whoa, I've had a day." And someone said, "Oh, watch this video," and I decided to share it with all of you.
Thank you. start to the retreat, a great hike, and now we can go into the lodge and talk about all the innovative stuff for the synagogue.
What's the matter? What's wrong with the lodge?
Rabbi, that's where we banished it. That's where it lives.
Where what lives?
The most terrifying, debilitating creature known to synagogues, churches, and institutions everywhere.
Seriously, you're really scaring me. Are you okay?
So is the demon real?
That's not funny. Of course it's real.
The way we've always done it, demon, strikes by taking a human form, by way of possession.
I get it, that there's safety in not wanting to change, but this demon is not safe. This demon can come for any of us at any time. It feeds off consistency.
It's okay, take a second.
I remember. 2009, after the market crashed and no one could afford any synagogue events, it got Janice Lieberman. Janice was such a sweet, enthusiastic woman.
I'm just so excited about Hanukkah.
For 18 years, she had planned our big Hanukkah fundraising dinner. And when we told her that this year Temple did not have the budget for the Hanukkah dinner, and that we would have to do holiday fundraising differently.
It just doesn't make financial sense. We have to come up with something else.
That's when it got her.
No, I'm tired of all the changes around here. This is the way we've always...
And after the demon got her, Janice still insists on planning the Hanukkah dinner, even though no one comes.
Hi, Karen. How are you? And Bernie, it's nice to see you. Be our guest. It's the way we've always done it.
This Hanukkah dinner is going to make the temple a lot of money.
Even though I know the demon's gone, the mere thought that it could return, it haunts me. It terrifies me. I thought I saw it in someone's eyes the other day.
We need to do something to change the dues model. We need to be innovative, something to encourage new membership.
You know, Karen, back in the early 1990s...
The demon.
Early 1990s. Back in the early 1990s, my wife and I really enjoyed watching L.A. Law. You okay, Karen? All I wanted to tell you was L.A. Law was a really good show.
It's been a great retreat so far, and I thought we could conclude here in the lodge and talk about what it means to be an innovative community now in the 21st century. I'd love to hear some big, out-of-the-box ideas. Tom.
How about no more dues?
Trisha.
How about we eliminate membership?
Lily.
What if we had a theater department?
I like that.
What about a pool?
How about an online religious school option?
These are really good ideas. Steve, we haven't heard from you yet. Are you okay, Steve?
Well, I'm a bit uncomfortable with change.
Steve?
The way we've always done it. My father's rolling in his grave.
No, this has got to stop.
Why do I pay more than the Goldberg?
I can't let this happen anymore. We've got to banish this demon.
Things were better when Bob Lowenstein was president. That's a good man, a true leader.
We can defeat this demon, but I need your help. Are you ready?
Did you get that cape at CVS?
Let's do what Jews do best. Give advice. Sean.
Change is painful, but it's necessary.
Rachel.
Don't let the past keep you from moving forward.
Max. No, Max, you can't wear that. It scares the kids.
I don't care.
That work? How about an ice cream truck coming to services every week?
I think people would like that.
Hi. I'd like to check out.
Absolutely. Hey, I heard you banished the demon.
Yep, we defeated the way we've always done a demon.
The way we've always done a demon? No, that's not the right one. I thought you were out there hunting the people are saying demon. People are saying that it's still out there. What have you done about it?
That was a little tepid. Later, they have another one that's called The Little Table that I'll show you at another time. This is the time in our service where we invite you to come forward to light a candle of joy and concern. Cindy Niebuhr from our Pastoral Care Committee will join us at the candle table. If you have a joy or concern you would like to have spoken aloud, please give it to Cindy on a piece of paper. There are also some cards up there if you didn't do that in the lobby. Please come up the center aisle and then return to your seats by the outer aisle to the table closest to you, and Dr. J will play for us during this time. You may come forward. A joy to announce that our staff and many of our volunteers received CPR AED training yesterday. We are in good hands, and it was a terrific, terrific training. So thank you to Terry Donaldson for arranging that for us. Thoughts and prayers for John Farrell, for Karen and Ricky. Don Knight is home recovering from surgery, and he would enjoy cards or phone calls. We are thinking of the Hoffman family. Gabriel, Logan, Scarlett, and Wolf welcome John Murray, who is named after his two great-grandfathers in March, and they have also just bought and renovated a new home. So I'm sure that the Hoffmans would love to also hear from you. And Helen Boxwell asks us to hold the family of James Beck in our hearts. He is the husband of Karen Beck, who is the Asian American Task Force Chair in Huntington. They have two teenage daughters, and he was killed walking on Jericho Turnpike a few weeks ago. In the spirit of those joys and concerns and the joys and concerns in your heart, please join me in a few moments of silence, meditation, reflection, and prayer. Spirit of life and love, be with us now. There are such impossible tragedies. A father of two teenage daughters killed crossing the street. People facing devastating illnesses and diagnoses, facing operations, spending time in hospitals. Grieving the loss of loved ones, facing financial difficulties, relationship difficulties, work difficulties. And yet today, like all days, we awake and we give gratitude just for being able to open our eyes and be here one more day. We celebrate advances in this community. We celebrate birthdays and babies, new homes, new jobs. This December season, with all of its joy and all of its complexity and all of its sorrows, and deep down inside, we experience gratitude. Gratitude for this day, as Winnie the Pooh said, this is going to be a great day. It might even be the best day ever. Let us take that gratitude and joy into the rest of our day, into this community, with deep thanks. Amen. So may it be.
Our split plate this month goes to HIHI, the Huntington Interfaith Homeless Initiative, which provides people without housing in Huntington with a safe, warm place to spend the night during the winter months. I assume most of us are going home to a warm, heated house today, and that is just not true for many of our neighbors. It's why the UUFH has been so committed to the mission of High High for several years. Comprised of more than 35 local congregations and in cooperation with the Suffolk County Family Service League, High High provides housing, clothing, a hot dinner, breakfast, and bag lunch to participants. In addition to giving generously to our split plate this month, you can also contribute by making dinners for the High High guests and delivering them to the host site, the Roadway Inn. To learn more about this wonderful opportunity, reach out to Melissa Dinsman.
Thank you.
so don't go anywhere, choir. I'm doing this totally impromptu, Jay. Can we just do the chorus? Because don't you all want to sing once? Like, we have to sing. You were really good about not singing, but I think we have to sing just the chorus, everybody, okay? Help from our friends. Get by with a little help from my friends. Get by with a little help from my friends. Do you need anybody? I just need someone to love. Could it be anybody? I just want someone to love. Oh, I get by with a little help from my friends. I get by with a little help from my friends. Yes, I get by with a little help from my friends. Yes, I get by with a little help from my friends. Thank you. All right, you all can be seated. I hope that was okay. I just, you know, Jenna and I were sitting up here trying not to sing, so thank you. That was just lovely. Isn't it amazing how you know all the words to those songs? Like, where are they living in our heads? At the end of the little video we watched, the desk clerk brings up a new demon. Do you remember what that new demon was? The people are saying demon. After my November 6th interim sermon, I was told some people are saying that this type of information doesn't belong at a Sunday service. Now, I want you to know that when you say people are saying to a minister, it has about the same effect as we've always done it this way. But to be fair, I want you to know these are not my favorite sermons to write or to give either. Still, there is important information that the entire congregation needs to know, and this is the platform to give them. I started last month's sermon with Reverend Cheryl Walker's reflections about how exciting it was for her to discover Unitarian Universalism. You may remember she said it felt like it was a religion created just for her. She wrote, "I was like a kid in a candy store. Me, 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 my faith, my journey, my religion. Thank you so much to all those people who came before me for making a religion just for me." Yet, what she goes on to say later in that essay is, quote, "The shadow side of supporting individuals is individualism, worship of the individual." Reverend Walker concluded, quote, "True community doesn't happen until everyone is willing to give up some of their identity as an individual to care about the group. We must move from individualism as the center of our focus and replace it with a concept of shared community, in which everyone gives up something to gain a lot." For about 5 years ago, the UUA has been talking about we church instead of I church. People in the I church ask, how does the congregation meet my needs? What's in it for me? Am I interested in today's sermon topic, or can I stay home? Do I personally agree with the decisions that were made about Christmas Eve this year? Or about the beehive, or the share the plate choice, the music, and so on? Am I getting my pledges worth? In contrast, in the we church, people ask, is the congregation meeting its mission of nurturing spirits and helping heal the world? What serves the whole community best? And am I willing to let go of what I personally might want for the good of the whole? People in the we church understand they come to services on Sunday not because you're interested in what the sermon is, but because being there supports each other in community. Because maybe today someone needs your smile, your how are you. People in a we church come to after services meeting because your input and presence is needed. They volunteer for committees and they make the most generous pledges they can. In 2020, the UUA published a book called Widening the Circle of Concern to address how the UUA and its congregations can promote diversity, equity, and inclusion. The report states that individualism is how we have perpetuated injustice and white supremacy. They write, "The centering of the individual de-centers the communal. One of the unintended consequences has been the atomized individualism of the search for truth and meaning without accountability to its impact on diverse communities." So I've shared with you before that I am bivocational. I have been a sexologist for more than 45 years and an ordained minister for 20 this May. In my first profession, in sexology, we teach that size doesn't matter. But in ministry, size matters. Congregation size matters. Congregation expert Carrie Newhoff writes, quote, "The difference between small churches and bigger churches is the difference between a mom-and-pop store and a large supermarket. In a small store, mom-and-pop are the finance department, the staff, the advertising department, the stockers, and the cashiers," end of quote. Mom-and-pop mop the floors, they order the supplies, they do the books, they're in charge of everything. They know all the customers, they may even know what a customer buys each week. Is that true at Stop and Shop in King Cullen? No. There is no mom-and-pop at Stop and Shop or King Cullen. In a supermarket, it takes a specialized team to run the store properly. The buyers, the department managers, the stock people, the back office people, the cashiers. All of those people work under a set of well-organized policies and procedures. The general manager does not know all the customers. And everyone knows exactly what their job responsibilities are and who can make what decisions. For example, does the butcher tell the bakery manager how to run their department? No. So you get it, right? You are no longer a family-sized congregation, our version of the mom-and-pop store. You have been a pastoral, moving-to-program-sized congregation for some time. However, and this is the mirror, your policies and governance model fit a congregation of under 100 members. We currently have, depending on how I count, 43 to 48 committees that report directly to your board of trustees. Any committee, indeed any one of you, can call the board of trustees and ask them to deal with one of your concerns. The flip side of that is the board, in turn, can overturn any decision any of you make. The board spends the bulk of its meetings dealing with operational concerns and has had little time for strategic planning. As I told you last month, the minister is held accountable for a great deal, but has little authority in the system aside from the worship services they lead. So as part of the interim goals, the board has begun looking at a model that will make more sense for a congregation of our size. It's called Modified Policy Governance, and it was created by a UU minister, the Reverend Dan Hotchkiss, while he was at an interfaith organization called the Alban Institute. Reverend Hotchkiss writes that this government structure, quote, "provides common clarity about the difference between governance and ministry, about which buck stops where, and how leaders will be held accountable for their decisions." For most of UUFH's history, you relied on the board to make all operational decisions, and then informal structures and relationships on how to get things done. As a church hovering around 210 members, that is no longer practical, and indeed is harmful, as the Widening the Circle reports warns us. That reliance on informal structures, this is a quote, means that new people cannot figure out how to contribute. If the way to get something done is to know the right people, this perpetuates an inner circle that causes hurt, discrimination, and can undermine the mission, goals, and work of the congregation. In this proposed new structure, there will be 12 major committees, not 43 committees. Four will report to the board as governance committees. Five will be ministry committees reporting to the minister. Two will report both to the minister and the board, and the nominating committee will report directly to the congregation. All the other activities, the book group, the Grow to Give Garden, the memorial committee, et cetera, will be considered subcommittees or teams under a major committee. And once that team's annual plan and budget is approved, they will be free to act and make decisions within that scope. So we're going to be holding a series of meetings with key leaders this winter, and then the congregation as a whole to get your input and to go over all this as the board finalizes what will be an experiment in governance. Y'all still breathing? Okay, good. The last piece of part two of this sermon is the important role you, all of you, are going to play in choosing the search committee, which will have the responsibility of identifying the best candidate for your next settled minister. I met with the nominating committee this past week to introduce the new ways, the more inclusive ways, that the UUA is asking us to form our search committee. According to our bylaws, the nominating committee chooses the search committee. However, the best practice that the UUA wants us to use has that selection beginning with all of you. In late January and February, a member of the nominating committee or a member of the board is going to call every local pledging member, sorry, Ken, we haven't talked about this yet, to ask you, but Jerry knows, to ask you to think about who would be an excellent member of the search committee. You will be asked to think about such things as who's committed to the overall congregation, not to a particular piece, who's been an effective leader, who gets along well with others, who will represent our congregation well to the ministers who will be looking at you. And then each of you is going to be asked for the names of up to three people in our congregation who you think meet those criteria. All of those names will then be compiled confidentially, and the people who are mentioned most frequently will be contacted by the nominating committee about their willingness to serve. The nominating committee will then put together a slate of seven people, and you will be asked to approve that slate at the congregational meeting in April. The UUA has a few requirements for the search committee. It should be diverse in age and sexual orientation, in time at the congregation, in experience, and in leadership. And this is important, it may not include current board members, any of the staff, or relatives of staff members. They also need to be people who can commit between 200 and 300 hours between July 2023 and April 2024. So this is not a job for the faint-hearted. We will be sending out more written information to all of you about what you can expect in those phone calls in January. All right, so that's kind of enough for this morning, especially because fire drill. And we have a congregational meeting. We will be talking more about covenant, mission, vision, and strategic planning at my next interim sermon in February. But let me end by returning to the video we watched. The antidote to "we've always done it this way" is to hold things lightly, to see changes as an experiment, to remember that nothing's permanent, to keep we church, not I church, and to withhold judgment, perhaps. Perhaps you have heard this Chinese parable about the farmer and the horse. Anyone think they know? Jay's nodding, yes. Once there was a Chinese farmer who worked his poor farm with his son and their horse, and then one day the horse ran away. The neighbors said, "That's terrible." And the farmer said, "Well, maybe yes, maybe no." When the horse returned, it was followed by a herd of wild horses. All the neighbors gathered around and said, "What good luck for you." The farmer stayed calm and said, "Maybe yes, maybe no." While trying to tame one of the wild horses, the farmer's son fell off the horse and broke his leg. He couldn't help with the farm chores. "How sad for you," said the neighbors. What did the farmer say? Maybe yes, maybe no. Shortly thereafter, a neighboring army threatened the village. All of the young men were drafted to fight the invaders. Many died. But the farmer's son, he couldn't go into the war because of his broken leg. People said to the farmer, "What a good thing it is that your son couldn't fight." And the farmer said, "Maybe yes, maybe no," and so on. So the message is clear, right? We don't really ever know the outcome of our decisions or of an event, and not becoming too attached to our desired outcome is important for all of us in our personal lives as well as in this community. Let me remind you that the reason for a religious home is not governance, and it's not to serve on committees. That's not why you came here. Those are only the means to accomplish our mission in the world. Religious community, to paraphrase historian Karen Armstrong, is, quote, not about accepting 20 impossible propositions before breakfast, but about doing things that change you. It is a moral aesthetic, an ethical alchemy. If you behave in a certain way, you will be transformed. Because isn't that what we're here for? To love each other, to be transformed, to transform the world. We know deep in our bones that that's the alchemy, that's the magic of what we can do and be together. We get by with a little help from our friends. As Reverend Robert Fulham reminded us 30 years ago, and it's still true, no matter how old you are, when you go out into the world, it's best to hold hands and stick together. So in that spirit, please rise and join us in singing Love Will Guide Us. It has guided this community for 75 years. May it continue to do so. I will be away from December 10th through December 17th working in Mexico, and I will make sure that there is someone on call, but I wanted you to know that. The closing words are words I've used before. If there is any good thing I can do, any kindness I can show to any person or any living thing, let me do it now. Let me not defer or neglect it, for I may not pass this way again. My friends, go in peace together. May our real service begin. And I will turn this over to Graham Otten. Put on your coats, it's cold outside.